What's up, my favorite PewTubers? It's time to finally do the review on the Streamlight TLR7. I've had the TLR7 now for about 2 or 3 months, and today we're finally gonna review it. So what's up, my favorite PewTubers? Welcome back to the channel, guys. So I originally picked up the TLR7 when we were doing the Polymer 80 Glock 26 build because the new Polymer 80 frames have a Picatinny rail on there, but the downside is it's very limited on what kind of lights will fit it. I actually did a full video on that, so if that's something you wanna watch later after this video, I'll put a link below so you guys can go check it out. I first got exposed to the Streamlight TLR7 when we were at SHOT Show this past year. And this is Streamlight's new compact model, I guess, to compete with Enforce and Surefire and Olight and all those other people. It's got a lot going on for it. However, there is one big con to this that might deter you from actually purchasing it. And that's something we're gonna answer as we go through this video. We're gonna dive up close here in a minute. We're gonna take a look at this up close, talk about what comes in the box, talk about the tech specs, things like that. And then at the very end, I'm gonna tell you, knowing what I know now, if I would buy it again, because I did purchase this light. No one sent it to me. I purchased it with my own money. So, but if this is something that you're interested in, guys, as always, if you're on YouTube, just check the very first link down in the description below. That way you can find the links for the best prices on everything that we talk about. So there are three things that I look for in every single weapon light, regardless of what it is or the brand or whatever. Number one are the activation switches that are on the gun. I need to be able to reach it from both sides of the gun. That is something that's important to me. Now, I understand that you're theoretically not supposed to activate a switch with your index finger. However, what if you don't have the use of your support hand and you can't reach it? How are you going to activate it? So we're going to talk about that. The second thing that I look for is, you know, it's durability. Obviously, you know, if you're gonna be carrying with a weapon light, you wanna make sure that it's gonna be sturdy enough for going in and out of the holster or if it gets banged. And I gotta be honest with you, I actually dropped this the other day when I was going outside to take some Instagram photos. I'm surprised the Glock didn't get scratched more than it did, but the light kinda took a beating. But I will say, it still works. So if it accidentally passed the drop test. So durability is the second thing that I look for. And then the third thing that I look for is the availability of holsters. A lot of times when there's a new light that comes out, it takes a minute for the holster companies to catch up because they need to get a mold for the light. Some people can make molds out of the actual light, but depending on the holster company, sometimes they actually need a mold for this so they can make clearance for it. So sometimes it can take, you know, 5 or 6, sometimes 7 months for the holster companies to catch up, especially if it's going to be something that you're going to carry. Availability of holsters is huge. So let's dive up close and let's see if this thing is going to pass the test or not.
All right, party people. So here we are up close and personal with the Streamlight TLR7. I got the box here. I have my Polymer 80 Glock 26 here just so we can talk about that a little bit. All right, guys. So I'm going to bring in a couple of other guns that have different lights on them so we can kind of do a little bit of comparing with them. Let's just get right into this. Here is the Streamlight TLR7. They also have this available as the TLR8. And the TLR8 has a little red laser on the bottom. I couldn't find a green laser version, so I'm not 100% sure if they actually have one or not. Have it right now on my Glock 19 Gen 5, just, you know, testing it on different platforms. So there's a couple of great features about this. First off, it is 500 lumens. And we'll talk more about this beam pattern here in a little while. 4300 candela, has a 1.5 hour runtime on a CR123A battery, which is really nice and pretty standard across the board. It only weighs 2.4 ounces and it measures 2.15 inches in length. And as you can see right here, it measures, I mean, let's just pretend that barrel isn't there. It measures 100% flush with the end of your muzzle. I mean, it is really good. It's also IPX7 waterproof, which means it can be submerged in 1 meter of depth of water for half an hour until it stops working. So here's the box that it comes with. In the box, you're gonna get all the different rail attachments for it so you can put it on a variety of different guns. And like I mentioned earlier, guys, it will fit onto this pick rail right here for the Polymer 80 Glock 26 frame, but you do have to modify the rail section a little bit. So I do have a video on that. And like I mentioned earlier, that video link will be in the description for you. So let's take it off out. Watch your little spring there that'll fall out. You can pull this out and then these rail sections right here, they just pop out and then you can put the, whichever one will work on your gun. Right now I have the 1913 hyphen number one on there. It fits my Glock just fine. And then to put it back together, you put your bolt back through it put your spring right there. Then you put your little rail section right here. Then you start threading it back on and you're good to go. For the battery on here, you just unscrew this front portion here. It has a nice little O-ring right here for your waterproofing. Really good looking internals. And then there is your CR123A battery. Positive side goes into the light, negative side sticks out the front. So right here, you'll notice something on this side. So now it's in the on position, right? Now you'll see here this little arrows right here. If you turn it until you feel your first detent, right there, that's where you feel it. It'll just stop. It won't turn on. Now the Enforce does that as well. So here's my Enforce. I can press the button, light comes on, but it doesn't have a stop. You just kind of unthread it a little bit and it will stop working. Here it is on the weapon. We're going to talk a little bit more about this here in a second, but in the firing position, you can see that my hands cannot hit these switches with my index finger. Now, speaking of the switches, you can see here, you can't press right here. You have to press this thin little sliver right here in order to turn the weapon light on. All you do to turn it on is you just press it once and you get constant on. If you press and hold it for longer than 1 second, you get momentary. But if you hit it too quick, it will stay on, so you don't get a quick flick. So here's Streamlight TLR1. They have a quick flick option where you can just hit that button really fast. You don't get that with really any of these weapon lights that are compact in size. Let's contrast that to, this is a Railmaster Pro that I got for the Polymer 80. And this one, it's not a great light. It's not a bad light. It's only 100 lumens and there's no momentary, but I love these paddles right here because these paddles extend right here to the very inside of the trigger guard where I can reach them with my fingers. Same thing for the Olight PL Mini Valkyrie. You know, right here, my finger can hit it, or on this side, my finger can hit it. Same thing with the Enforce APL-C or APL Full Size. These are my favorite ones. Right here, they come up to this point here, and I can activate it with that finger, or I can activate it with that finger with no issues. I've noticed with this, though, I do have to hunt around a bit to find it before I can activate it. And we'll talk more about that here in a second when we jump up top. But I just wanted to give you kind of a comparison on these different lights for my Glocks and things like that. Take a look at the beam pattern. Then we'll go over the pros and cons of this light. And then at the very end, I'm gonna tell you, knowing what I know now, if I would purchase this again or not.
Back up top. So there it is, up close and personal, guys, with the Streamlight TLR7. The tech specs are pretty much going to be identical for the Streamlight TLR8 as well. It just has a red laser on the bottom. I don't know 100% if there is a green laser version. I was looking online and I didn't see one. So if you're watching this on YouTube, though, like I say, guys, I'll just check the very first two links down in the description and that'll take you to where you can find all the links for these. And if there is a green laser version of the TLR8, I will include that as well as a bunch of coupon codes of various places where you can purchase it. That way you guys can get the best price. Now, let's talk about the pros and the cons of this and whether or not I would buy it knowing what I know now. So I want to preface this with, this has a lot of pros about it, a lot. And it does fit the Polymer 80 PF940SC, but you do have to modify one of the little inserts that comes with it. That is a pro right off the bat, that it will fit the Polymer 80 PF940SC, whereas like my Enforce APL and my Olight PL Mini, I can't even mod those to make them fit that. So that's definitely one pro. Pro number two is it is very much flush with the muzzle of the gun. Now there is a theory out there where if the light does extend past the muzzle of the gun, that it could be used as a standoff device. And what that is if someone was on top of you and you had your gun, let's make sure this is clear. Okay, very much clear. If someone was on top of you and their body was pushing into the gun, you can't pull the trigger. Whereas if you had one that extended past the muzzle, you could theoretically pull the gun down and then pull the trigger. So there is a lot of merit to that school of thought. However, I think for concealed carry, a lot of people want them to be flush mounted just because it makes it a lot more comfortable, especially if you're carrying in the appendix position. The size of it is beautiful. I love how small it is. Now, the next pro is the lumens or the brightness or the candela. 500 lumens, plenty of brightness. Candela on this is 4300 and it has a really nice tight beam pattern with a little bit of flood. So with the beam pattern, sometimes you have a very wide wide burst of light, and then sometimes you have a very narrow hotspot. It just kind of depends on what your application purposes are. I kind of feel like the beam pattern on this one is perfect for if you're clearing a room and you're just using the flood of the light, or if you just need to press out and identify your target, you can also do that and use the hotspot to really kind of throw off whoever's trying to attack you. So I really feel like the beam pattern is really nice on that, at least for my purposes. You might think differently. The next pro is the weight. It's only 2.4 ounces. You barely can tell it's there, but when I was at the range shooting it, I noticed that little 2.4 ounces actually mitigated some of the recoil. So that's a nice little byproduct bonus right there for you. And then the next two pros are the battery life, 1.5 hours of runtime. That seems to be standard across most weapon light. And then I also like the fact that it uses the CR123A batteries, which are easy to find. You can get them at CVS, you can get them at Walmart. Most places carry CR123As. Now let's talk about the cons. So the first con is there doesn't seem to be a standard price for this. Now, when this first came out, I believe the price was around $200-ish. It was really expensive for a light in this class. However, they are starting to come down and they're like $110 to $115. Like I said, just check the links below. That way you can find the best prices and coupon codes. So the price has come down since it initially came out. Now let's talk about the biggest con, at least in my opinion. There's two cons about the switches that I don't like. Number one, it's a little bit weird. So for example, it's just this little tiny sliver line of a switch, and you have to press that little tiny sliver in order to activate the light. The next con is I don't feel that this light reaches back far enough to the trigger guard to activate it with my index finger if I needed to. Unless you have hands the size of Hickok 45, you're not gonna be able to activate this with your trigger finger. And like I said earlier in the video, I know you're not theoretically supposed to always activate a light with your trigger finger, but what if you don't have access to your support hand? So you need to be able to be in your firing grip and be able to activate the light, at least in my opinion. I think that's super important. I don't know what you think, but that's what I think. So looking at the gun on this side, if I'm gonna activate it with my support hand, I gotta go way down here to catch that tiny little sliver so I can activate it. And to me, it's very cumbersome if I have my sights aligned and I need to activate that light. To me, the switches kind of kill it. This is what I think Streamlight needs to do. So if you notice when we were looking at this up close, there's three Allen bolts on the backside of the switches. I think if they just created little module switches where people could pick and choose which modules they want to get for activation, I think that would be huge. I mean, because personally, I would love to have switches like the Enforce switches where they kind of reach back into here and I can still activate it with my trigger finger. Or they could even take some switches like they have on their TLR1s and do something like that. But I would just love to see something like that because it looks like the hardware is already there for that. So now let's answer the question. Knowing what I know now, would I buy it again? No, I wouldn't buy it again. And here's why. The most important thing to me is to be able to activate the switches in any firing position that I might find myself in, whether I have my support hand available or I don't. So for me, I'm not gonna carry it because my fingers aren't long enough. Now, if your fingers are long enough to reach it and you don't have any issues with it, then hey, by all means, I think it's a great purchase otherwise. And the way you can measure this is to take your gun and put your index finger out and see how far past that trigger guard your finger will extend. Your finger needs to extend all the way, probably about a quarter inch past the trigger guard in order to activate it with your index finger if you needed to. So here are my two alternatives to this light. If lumens are super important to you, like you need to have a lot of lumens, then I highly suggest the Olight PL Mini Valkyrie. It's not a bad little light. You know, I don't prefer these switches, but I definitely prefer the switches over this one. I can still reach these with my index finger right here if I need to. However, on the support hand side, it is a little bit cumbersome. I have to reach down and then I have to pull my thumb back in order to hit those switches. So to me, it's not quite ideal for me to carry, but I would carry with this light because at least I can reach it with both hands. Now, secondly, if lumens are not super important to you, because guys, lumens are not everything. Trust me, if you can't turn on your light, it doesn't matter if you got a million lumens, it ain't gonna be shining on anything if you can't reach it with your fingers. My all-time favorite weapon light to date is still the Enforce APL-C. Despite the fact that it's only 200 lumens, this is plenty of light for me. Maybe your circumstances are different, but what sets this light apart for me are these activation switches. I can reach them with this hand, no problem. When I come to this side, Boom, I could just reach it right there. Not an issue. This is pretty much the only compact light where I don't have any issues with the switches on either side of the gun, regardless of how I activate it. So this is my all-time favorite for concealed carry, and it costs about the same as the TLR7. Now, the most affordable one of all these is obviously gonna be the Olight PL Mini Valkyrie. They're only like $79, whereas these two are about $110, depending on where you get them. Regarding compact weapon lights, not the ones that extend past the muzzle, but you know, stuff like the PL Mini Valkyrie, the TLR7, TLR8, and the Enforce APLC, which one of these do you prefer? And let me know why. But if you like this video, just go ahead and smash the like button, kick it, sit on it, do whatever it is that you like to do, and subscribe if you're not already. But until next time, I love you, and you guys stay sexy.